Good morning.
Good morning.
It's quite early for a large audience, I think. But it doesn't matter. I want to talk about how we are using Debian in a somewhat larger infrastructure at the German Federal Foreign Office, or another name would be the Ministry for Foreign Affairs. Or in contrast to other talks, I will talk about even about some problems we have seen in Debian. I wouldn't mention any problems in Debian in other talks, but I think the local audience can cope with it. That's it. First of all, I want to talk about, or I want to introduce you to our IT department. We have four IT units in the headquarter in Berlin and Bonn, and these are central IT units. So our IT units aren't scattered around in different locations. So that might be different to other institutions. We have more than 11,000, almost 12,000 computers or client computers worldwide. Yeah, most of them are located outside Germany. I think 75% are abroad. We have way over 200 missions. These are embassies and general consulates. For instance, there's a general consulate in Edinburgh. And we have two IT service centers, two small IT service centers, I must add, in New York and Singapore, that are responsible for giving IT support in the time zones outside or far from Europe and Africa, especially America and Asia. And overall, we have very little IT staff abroad. Most of the IT is located in Germany, and all the administration is done remotely. I work at a very small unit. It's called IT Strategy. It's like a CIO unit, directly working for the head of IT. We are managing the IT budget, responsible for the IT security, and we are making strategic decisions like introducing Debian to the ministry. And as a side note, I got my job through our formal project leader, Martin Michelmeier, who wrote a mail to Debian Private about the job offer, and I just got that job. So it's worth doing, working with Debian, or for Debian, if you like to get a job. Okay, the next is I want to talk about the history, or our IT history. Until 2003, we had rapid servers at our missions, usually one rapid server at the mission. We are using up to now IPsec over internet for secure connectivity of our missions, and we're using a German branded product called Xena, secure internet network architecture. It's a project of our national security agency called ESI. On the clients, we have used Microsoft Windows XP and Microsoft Office as missions, and at the headquarters we have still used Microsoft Windows NT at the servers and the clients, including such things like Microsoft Outlook and Exchange. So it's quite a classic installation, except for the rapid servers. That's maybe unusual for this time. 2004, we have introduced Debian to the Foreign Office. We have used it for so-called internet terminal servers that are used to have some more secure access to the internet. So there's no direct, at least no direct attack vector to our network, to our mail servers, or to our file file servers into our client computers, because everyone has to use a terminal server to access the World Wide Web. And we have started installing more and more internet web applications on Debian servers. In 2005, we have refreshed the hardware and software in the headquarters. Since this year, almost all servers are Debian servers in the headquarters. And the clients have a multi-boot configuration where Windows XP is installed and Debian is installed in the clients, and the users can choose which operating they want to use. And we have removed the Microsoft Outlook stuff completely and replaced them with Thunderbird and Firefox, and installed Office at least in addition to Microsoft Office and that stuff. 2006, I would call that the speeding up phase. We have started installed or replaced servers in the missions, because they are just too old, and even clients, not even only servers, even clients. And all new servers are Debian servers, and all new clients are multi-boot clients like in the headquarters. And we have started to install Debian only on every notebook. So everyone who wants to get a notebook has to use Debian. There's no option. And these installations use this special Xena-based virtual private network products that, or a special kernel supporting such Xena VPN and the user tools that are necessary to set up the VPN. This year, I would say, is the start of the final phase. We are starting to migrate some missions to Debian only. About 1 week ago, we have migrated the embassy in Oslo to Debian only. It was quite easy, I would say. After that, there are no real big problems. And currently, we are migrating the embassy in Cairo, which quite a bit more larger, and I hope that there are no problems. And we are using VirtualBox for the VirtualBox emulation for legacy software, like non-free operating systems. That works quite well too, I must say.
One question, so the final phase has the goal to migrate all missions completely to Debian?
Yes, all missions and
after
in the headquarter.
After that you do not have work anymore.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, okay, my job is done then. Probably not, because there are still a lot of things to do. Before I come to problems in Debian, I will talk about advantages of Debian, but I think I can keep it short, because everyone knows more or less what are the advantages of Debian. But I will just mention the major points. Debian has a large package pool and a large developer community. It's not business driven. That means we are dependent. We don't have to fear that the Debian organization is making contracts with Microsoft. That's a big advantage. That's a really big advantage you should be aware of. It's a real open source distribution. Nobody cares if you are recompiling your kernel. You can just do it, and you will get support through the bug tracking system, even if you are using your code. Users can easily contribute. That's quite a good advantage. We have a bug tracking system. We have collaborative development of packages. You can contribute to translations. You can start even the new maintainer process for yourself. And what's interesting, Debian still have a focus to end users. If it's not that easy to install Debian, we still have the focus compared to other community projects, especially if you compare us with other large community projects, and that are maybe Gen 2 or the 3 BSDs that are community projects. but I think they are less focused to the MTLR. And yes, the high stability is always a good thing, so the bug tracking system to the strict release process in such a commercial installation. Now I will describe our development infrastructure, or our installation infrastructure. Our goal is to package everything we have in .deb format for easy distribution installation, even package Microsoft Office templates in .deb format, because when we use them in the virtual box emulation, because it's just easier to distribute them in .deb format. For that we need installation and development infrastructure. We have our own mirror, we have a components archive with upload queues, a build server, we have our own policies, how to build packages. And we are using the usual software, Bugzilla, the version, Git, mailman-based mailing list, MediaWiki service, and the OTIS ticket system. More or less for most for support the end user. One problem is that it's still too hard to set up such an infrastructure and to maintain such an infrastructure, I think. It costs a lot of manpower to keep that running and to set up. For instance, all the tools I have mentioned don't have proper LDAP support or very limited LDAP support, but LDAP is just necessary in such an organization. And we are still missing a lot of helper tools. We have to write a lot of helper tools for archive maintenance. You want to have such things like the package tracking system for yourself, but you have to do it more or less yourself. There's no package git install package tracking system or something that works. It would be nice to have such things in Debian that makes it easier to set up your own development infrastructure. We even have written our own installer. It's not because Debian installer is bad. It's not. Debian installer is a good tool, quite a good tool, but it just did not fit our needs, or simply or does not fit our needs today. And at least some years ago, we found out that it's too difficult to fix the Debian installer. It's easier just to write your own installer. Instead of fixing it. Maybe we should change that in the future and fix Debian installer so we can use it directly. What we are doing with our installer, we're doing automatic setups, of course, upload balancing heartbeat clusters. That's not easy to do with other types of installers. We are setting up distributed remote block devices. It must be done in sync with an every partner. And the logical volume manager on top of the RBD. I'm not aware that any other tool is able to do that fully automatic. You can write your scripts, of course. That's what we have done at least two. We have written scripts and packaged some legal packages, and that's what is doing that. We can create installation media of any kind you need, CD-ROMs, DVD-ROMs, network-based installations, whatever you need. We can support virtual machines, it's not too difficult, like Xen, virtual box. And we can support image-based installations, which is necessary if you want to install other operating systems that don't have a proper installer, like Windows. Or if you want to buy your hardware pre-installed with your operating systems, it's usually easier if you get your hardware and the operating system is already pre-installed. At least you are faster to set up your machine. And we can separate the installations from the setup process. That's more or less the same. We get the hardware pre-installed with software, and we're just setting up the machine when, before the user gets it, before the server starts working, and we're just changing host name, root password, whatever is needed in a more or less half automatic way. Yeah, the next point I would categorize as policy-like, more roughly as policy-like problems. One problem with a lot of daemon packages is that we need to run a daemon twice or more than that on the same machine. If you have a heartbeat cluster, a load balancing heartbeat cluster, usually if one of the partner breaks, the other partner needs to run all daemons alone. And that means you need to avoid hard-coded paths to files and directory, like we had problems with Zamba in that, that had some hard-coded paths, so you couldn't run Zamba twice on your machine. This was simply necessary, you had to change that. Other daemons support that, like Postgres. You can install Postgres multiple times in multiple instances, that's not that difficult. But Postgres lacks a way to automatically reconfigure such an installation. So you still need some kind of scripts that just doing the setup. That would be nice if that the packages even would be able to or have a way to reconfigure them. So if you install them, you automatically have two Postgres instances. There one is automatically started, or also they are automatically started via heartbeat, not via scripts directly. Another problem is the user ID, group ID mapping on shared storage. Debian uses a lot of dynamic user IDs and group IDs during the installation. That's not possible if you're using shared storage, like the RBD we are using, or any kind of storage area network that we have in our headquarter. Most of our servers in the headquarter are just directly booting from the storage via network, so we have naturally a shared storage there. At least on the shared storage, it's necessary that you have some fixed mapping between numeric IDs and names. And it would be nice if Debian would have a way to pre-seed such methods. The way is just to create all necessary users and groups very early in the installation process, so the packages itself don't create users and groups dynamically. But that's some kind of dirty fix, so it would be nice to have something that is backed up by policy in Debian or something. Debian does not define a central configuration database. You can build something like that with dipconf and things, but there's no definition for a central configuration database. So you have to invent yourself, one for yourself. It would be nice if we had a mechanism that just works in Debian. And the configuration mechanism is not extensible. What I mean here, there are packages that can be preceded by dipconf, like OpenSSH server or something, SSH server, OpenSSH server or something. But if you want to configure more than what the maintainer has intended, then you have to invent your own. You either have to change the package OpenSSH server, or you have to just override the configuration file or something. There's no way to extend the mechanism that the maintainer has built in Debian. I want to go or explain it the configuration file handling more deeply, because that's what we need at least, because we have a central configuration database in an LDAP server, and we don't configure any server or client directly. Every configuration item that needs to be changed on the central LDAP server, and needs to be replicated to the actual configuration file in Debian. One advantage is, of course, that we have plain text configuration files. That's a real advantage. but we have no good mechanisms to replicate such configuration vector from the central server to the actual DBN machine. The D package conf files are not very flexible. For instance, you cannot presage things like force conf old and force conf new for UDTL files. That's sometimes could be a good thing. UCF at least uses some environment variables, like UCF force conf new and UCF force conf old, and it uses step conf. But UCF is not required to use for every given package, and it's not even flexible enough, I think. So it's a bit better, but it's not good enough. Another missing tool, I think, is some kind of diversion tool for configuration files. We don't have such things. And the conf handling of the package is not even fully documented. I have an example from the policy I found. I just searched for some for the 0.5. You see, the policy explains what happens during purging a Debian file, and it mentions that some files get removed, but it ends at zero. So you don't know what really happens during purging. It just takes everything, just ends somewhere. And there's no documentation what happens during purging the Debian package. Except the source code of the package explains it, of course. Moving configuration files from one package to another with name changing or without name changing is another problem difficult to handle, especially if you have a lot of your own packages and sometimes you want to move just configuration file from one to another, or you want to split a large package into sub-packages and move the configuration files around, and you always get headaches what happens during upgrade. And at least I found it difficult to find out what happens during such stuff. And another mechanism that would be very nice is to use run parts for configuration files, especially, for instance, the sudoers would be nice to split up in small files and have a directory, sudoers.d, that just contains all the files and that get combined into one configuration file, sudoers and during hostings or whatever. And would be nice to have a default mechanism that just works for every conf file you can imagine, and that even supports migration from the old scheme to the scheme with multiple files that gets combined. It's so difficult to write a script, but it would be nice to have it in Debian. Another thing is if configuration files gets overwritten, that you have numbered backups, for instance, of the old file, so you can just use a diff to see the difference to the old version. Yes, I already mentioned the central database of configuration data. Currently we have LDAP backend of depconf, but that's still experimental as far as I know, and it's very limited in what you can do. So it's not really usable for any practical purpose, as far as I know. So the best option is to use plain files, plain depconf files that you distribute around in a way, in some way, via HTTP or whatever. But that's not even a standard mechanism. So we are missing a standard mechanism, and a mechanism that uses well, something that we would like to have is a template mechanism where we have a template for configuration files and some items in the config file gets replaced by data from central LDAP, whatever, and the final file is written by replacing parts of the configuration template. And that mechanism should be extensible, of course, so it should not be limited to what the maintainer thought is usable every user that uses the debugger package should be able to easily extend the repository. And of course, if you would have a central database, you would need some kind of user front end, some user interface, for instance, a web application or something like to change the database. That's missing too. Okay, so I'm just only at the end. I have uploaded my slides already to Petapath. Maybe I need to update the latest version. Update it tonight, but yeah. If you have questions.
I think the idea of how to handle a configuration file with a dpkg work-like tool is very interesting. I talked to some other guys, and the idea was how to handle, for example, also the custom Debian distribution. Currently, as far as I know, Skoda Linux, for example, is creating an Apache package on their own, so they can include their conf files for the web server even. And I think it would be much better that Debian has only one Apache package with some basic configuration, and other packages like the Skoda Linux environment package, or you would create a package only with the config files. So you can create an Apache web server with the plain Debian files where the binaries are mostly included, but the config files comes from your package. And currently, I think one great problem is that the policy says that a package cannot overwrite or change config files from another package.
So this has come up as a question or issue several times over the years, and I think that my attitude has always been very similar to what you're suggesting. The right answer was for us to come up with a standardized way of handling this that would meet everyone's needs, and then it would be completely appropriate to change the policy to support such a mechanism. I think the reason the policy is written the way it is now is that it would be complete chaos if many different people invented different mechanisms of overriding each other's config files, and we would all have a really difficult support issue. So I hope that people don't read things like that in policy as things that can't be changed, just as good indications of how we should behave until we have a good idea or come up with a good solution for fixing it.
My first idea was if there would be a tool like dpkg work for the conf files, that for example the Skoda Linux configuration package could tag those config files that they like to change with this maybe the version and label it with Skoda Linux. So the plain Debian package system would know, oh, if I do an upgrade of the plain Apache package, I do not have to touch several conf files. But the Skoda Linux package, if there would be an update of the package, it says, oh, these are under my control, so I can update the versions except the user had made some manual changes to it.
I think, doesn't it say in the policy somewhere that just versions on conf files are broken, not actually not intended to work? It seems like this is something that could actually work if you just sort of get this message, right? I didn't really get the feeling that it's sort of prohibited.
Even if it's not allowed currently, I think this is the second or the third time I heard that we need something like this. So I think it's a very hot topic, and it would be very good maybe to have a BOF or for the next conference to make this a BOF, so we can talk about this, because a lot of people can use this feature.
There are a lot of different interest groups actually who pretty much wouldn't need the same.
Yeah.
And I think there's another idea that you had in your list involving this notion of configuration, more configuration files having a directory for delivery of fragments. Petra Anholson has certainly been talking now for at least 3 years, if not longer, about the idea of config file layering. And it seems to me that some combination of this, there's some configuration files that I think are structured in a way that layering and sequencing to have things override defaults works well. And then there are things like the bind config file that you really just have to be able to replace.
Yeah.
And so some combination of these methods, well articulated and well documented, might be a very good thing for us to have.
It strikes me that if we're going to do something like that, it really does need to be done with the active involvement of other Linux distributions as well, though, because for those of us who are, for one reason or another, running heterogeneous environments because we have to, like myself, you know, I don't want to have a completely different configuration scheme for SUSE that I have for Debian, so it really can't be, it's something that I don't think we can do in isolation.
So that would suggest that in addition to coming up with a good proposal, we should figure out how to engage the LSD folks and folks in other distributions who worry about this in the process.
Well, my feeling, which is sort of subjective, that other distributions only have an configuration technology, so a lot worse actually. So I'm not sure there's all that much quality there in the hands.
What was your what is your current solution for this problem of the config file handling?
We have I have tried to find out. I think we have five solutions. One is worse than the other. So we don't have a real solution for that. Sometimes we are just setting the DH compact version to back to 2, where that helper does not define every file below server as a conf file. Sometimes we are just removing the Debian conf files by, sometimes we're just overriding them by post install on something like that and setting dpkg.
Where is the right place for us to continue this conversation?
The fourth conf old configures, so make sure that the Debian package itself does not override our configuration files.
I think all involved people like yourself and the custom distributions and whoever else just needs to sort of find a forum and discuss the requirements at the moment.
Is this something that belongs on the Bell or the CD list? Someone suggest a place for this conversation to continue and perhaps we can focus on this.
I would say it's Debian Devil. Because a lot of people that need some sort of this thing don't think about that.
Okay.
This would be a custom Debian distribution that they are creating.
My last question on the Debian custom, and they are so focused in doing a CDD that they have too much, as in, how to say, they need a different approach to change conf files than what you, if you just want to be a personalized Debian needs. But I think myself, I need to personalized Debian, I need a simple approach, something that can work now or in the very near future. For now, what I'm using is I install my package with scripts and patches that change the conf files after the installation. And it's working enough for me, but I'm looking too for some other way to do this.
And my idea was to enhance UDF in a way that suitable for such a job and try to convince the maintainers to use UCF for installing configuration files. But I've learned that Manu is a bit strict about changing UCF or adding more features to UCF, so probably you need another tool. Fixing the package might be too difficult, was around this.
But you can create a package called UCF Next Generation.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that was
well,
a problem. As a starting point, using UCF, but creating something else.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was going to suggest that sometimes the right way to convince all of us of these things, the fact that we're in a technical committee, another technical committee issue last night, is to at least build a prototype of what you're talking about and demonstrate how this will make the world a better place.
Yeah.
And then it's much easier for people to rally support and to decide that this is a change worth making. It's difficult sometimes for a paper design to achieve much sense of consensus
what I might do next year when we have switched everything to Debian, so I have more time for some stuff. I've even tried to build a prototype, but it's far from being presented somewhere because it's too limited. Even don't use it in our project. So it's just
But I think the first step would be to collect the people that are interested in this topic. So
to document the limitations.
So
I think that was the idea behind the talk. Start with documenting the thing, maybe even the key
at
the talk and as a starting point.
And if you could document missing features or the problems you had, I think we can, or people will get involved and see, oh, there's something documented that's also interesting for me, so the people will come together in the future.
Yeah, maybe I will start that.
I think it's very important because if somebody only reads the title of your talk, you would never expect that this kind of topic would be a part of your talk. And I think it's very, very interesting that you also had the problem and thought about how to solve it. And so first thing we have to point out.
I tried to explain this in the abstract, but I didn't even want to be too open because usually in the public I don't want to talk too much about Debian problems. It might sound like Debian is the best solution.
It's not about problems, it's about new things that we will invent in the future.
Yeah.
But hopefully.
Yeah, okay.
I think it's completely appropriate for even for those of us who truly love and make heavy use of this distribution talking about where we need to go next. So
yeah.
I don't see a problem. Yes. In fact, I've been chatting with some folks on IRC in the last few minutes who I think are a little sad that they didn't come out to hear your presentation at this point, but we'll make sure to see it later.
Just out of curiosity, what hardware is it?
What hardware? Yeah, we are using it. On servers, HP. On the clients, usually the with the Siemens PCs and ThinkPads. As notebooks, that's more or less for a storage network. We are using EMZ in that quarter.
What do you use for remote management?
Secure Shell? Or remote management? You mean something like Nagios? Yeah, Nagios.
No, I mean the box needs to do that bias configured and so on.
No, we don't use any conversion tool for such things. But I don't really understand what you.
I mean, okay.
We are in the service. We are using the what HP provides as the ILO cards for remote.
That's actually a pretty good tool set. The only thing I would caution you about is that if you're going to buy a bunch of HP servers and try to remotely administer them, you want to think about including the advanced pack ILO option because you need to have that available to give remote access to the graphic version of the console.
It sucks a bit using access to it's good enough.
The good news is it does support remote SSH access, and you can do things like boxes remotely, things like that. So they work pretty well.
You said about problems using the LDAP backend on DevConf.
The LDAP backend on DevConf.
You understand? The LDAP.
The LDAP backend.
Yes.
The
backend. I do try to use it as only as a read-only database, as a way to press into the package?
No, not really, because that can be accomplished in other ways that are probably less complex. Basically, we have just, I think, 9 depth values that we are transiting, and that's just a plain file we are distributing and including our depth configuration. Although it's simpler, that's quite simple.
When we were talking about using something like a conf file directory to deliver aggregate fragments, example, I know you were thinking this is a more general mechanism. The example you used was sudo. Have you ever tried the sudo LDAP backend support?
That would be an option in that case, but that's not a general option.
Yeah, right. I was just curious.
No, we haven't used that. We have thought about that, but I don't know the reasons why. Maybe it was easier, it was too complex to set up the LDAP, so whatever. I don't really know what the actual reasons was, not to use it, but we have considered that.
Right, okay, I was just curious, because I maintain that.
I think one of the problems is that sudo must work even if you don't have network connectivity, and that you must make sure that.
That's correct. And so, as the sudo maintainer and someone who does not personally babysit any LDAP, I'm always curious if my people have some experience with it.
Indonesia's motto is unity in diversity. And you can see by the news how well they're getting along. The problem is that as the country has grown, people are educated in different areas. And instead of everybody learning everything, they learn their unique area, and that causes conflict with the people in one area thinking that the problem is in some other area. As an outsider, this is my first Debian conference. My analysis is that what is needed most is somebody that is unbiased, very creative, very good documentation writer, to start at the very, and document all of Debian and how it should come together. I think we're documenting individual projects, but I'm not hearing that we're documenting the whole system, and I'm hearing conflicts about one installer versus another installer and all kinds of different things. It seems to me that some documentation that brought people together would be the greatest thing, and that's just an outsider's opinion.
I think the problem is you get biased very, very quickly.
Yeah, I don't think there's any such thing as an unbiased person.
Yes.
Well,
what we have done.
I'm talking from my experience.
Yeah, that's it.
What we,
I think the more you get into something, the more biased you are if you're into one particular area but not into other areas.
But isn't Debian just like any other area of human endeavor that is way too big for any one person to have even moderate grasp of the whole thing? It's just not feasible.
And you cannot create one solution for all. So it's about diversity. For sure, it's better to make some things, to unite some things into a more general solution, but you cannot do everything for all. And I mean, it's basically a good idea, but you don't want to have everything the same. You can't start all using Microsoft because that's what already most people use. It's just a stupid idea to use Linux and even have multiple distributions.
I don't agree right there.
Why not?
There's ways in which diversity is better, and unity in diversity. diversity, I think, is the greatest concept. But my observation is that as people become more and more specialized, they tend to think that their own area is the most important, and conflicts arise with other areas. But
you have to remember that in the open source community, there's quite a strong element of sort of natural selection of work. And actually having people are trying different things all the time, and sooner or later, a consensus is arrived at. It may not happen in a particularly organized and directed fashion, but I think there is natural selection at work. And
well, I don't see it.
Oh, it does happen.
There are so many good conference, free conference organization software around. And this conference is based on five vomits. And I haven't been able to even find anyone, after asking more than a dozen people, how to solve the simplest problem with Pentabar. You know, so I don't see natural selection at work. I see somebody having a pet project and hoisting on us the worst conference software I've ever seen.
Yeah,
I think this one was worse.
That's true, but you cannot change it from today to tomorrow. How what do we want? We all realize that Pentabug might be quite bad, and now should we try to reprogram it in one day? For the next conference,
I'd rather do it yourself.
Was as natural selection already proved to be very good, rather than trying to rewrite Pentabar.
Natural selection takes years. So animals and stuff, they didn't change from one day to another to be able to live in the water. They needed thousands of years to do such things.
The idea behind open source is to do it yourself. And I have looked for the Pentabug installation for the DevCon by myself, because I've seen the problems, and just fix it. Yeah. That's the idea behind the whole thing.
You're right, it's bad. It's really, I had many problems with it. So in the start, there wasn't even a link from the login to see the schedule and back. So, but yeah, you cannot change it in one day, but you can. Everybody who has some time can keep in mind that there is a system that is not optimal, but it worked in general, and we can help to make it better for next year.
Yeah, I think it will
and
much
if you come up with something 1000% better for next year, then I think a lot of people, if you show that to some people, a lot of people will help you to get this for the next year. This is all, everything a process. So.
And half of my patches have been included by the upstream developer, and he is quite responsive, so that's how open source works. And,
I don't think your ideas are bad in general, but everything takes a lot of time for sure, and no one single person will document the whole Debian project, and this is really impossible. But there are people working on unifying and documenting stuff, but even the existence of other people who create another wiki about Debian, maybe in another language, already then you have splitting of information. And there are so many interests that you cannot just say nobody is allowed to do a Debian wiki somewhere else, for example. So I don't see how these things can be done in practical. For sure, we can remind people it's better to use the Debian wiki, but instead of create your own, and it's better to work on general solutions, but everybody cooking his own soup, but sometimes people have different needs. And for sure, DI could evolve to something very, very good at automatic installations, but I have to meet today, and that's why I'm using FAI, for example. Maybe I could invest very, very much energy, and in 5 years, DI can do the same as FAI today. But yeah, and for the BI people, it's exactly the other way around. They need something what is manually capable of doing a lot. They are not so much interested in automatic stuff. They need it today, for sure. I can say to them, yeah, if we work on this in 5 years, we have all the manual interaction you have now in DI, you have this in 5 years in FAI, but I am not interested to work on it, and the people who want it need it today. That's why we have two different installers, for example. Yeah, maybe even more, but that's the two most important, I think. But
yeah,
that is the reason for diversity, so sometimes diversity has a reason.
Yeah.
Well, you're way over my head about DI versus FAI, but I asked somebody else about which one, and he says, why make a choice? Why not DI support FAI and people work in FAI and finally, I mean, why not hook the two of them together?
If you want that, yeah. That's why it's open source. If there is somebody who needs to hook them together, then you can hook them together. Currently, I see it more as two different solutions which do something what in the end might look the same in two different ways, and because people have the need to do these things in two different ways. The one wants to click everything together because maybe he has no two computers of the same type in hardware or software installation. So you don't want to create an automatic installation for that, but yeah, I have an idea why you want to do that, because it's reproducible. Yeah. But this is just one example where diversity has a reason, and yeah, one could try to put them somehow together, but
you might end up with a jack of all trades and master of none if you try to shoot one together.
So I think before we start another talk,
yeah,
end the talk. If there are no other questions anymore, we can come to the end and discuss it.
Yeah.
Thank you.